Hey, good morning, Fusion at home. I am so glad to be with you here today. I'm actually on the computer with our ministry leader for Celebrate Recovery. Hey, Lee, how you doing?
Hi, Corey. I'm doing great. How about you?
Great. What's going on with Celebrate Recovery? How's things going with that? This is the first time anybody's ever met you from our online at home family, at least virtually.
Well, I'm really glad to meet you all. And I want to tell you, I'm really excited about Celebrate Recovery. We're making a difference in lives because we're helping people overcome the hurts, the habits, and the hangups that have been limiting or preventing them from experiencing the life God wants them to have. This is a place where you come to get away from the stuff that's hurt you and held you back all your life and move forward towards the goal for which God is calling you heavenward in Christ Jesus.
Great. When does CR happen? You have it here at the building, correct?
We have CR at the building on Friday nights. Our large group is at 6:30, and that's where everybody meets all together. Then we break off into open share groups, and those are segregated by gender. So women meet with women and men meet with men. And then as we grow, it will also be segregated by the particular issue you have, whether it's alcoholism or codependency or depression or anxiety or whatever it might be. We're working toward having groups for that. And then we also have a step study for men. It meets on Monday nights, but that's flexible. And the women meet on Wednesday nights. And that's designed to go deeper into the word and deeper into recovery and really deal with all of the issues that have been at work in your life.
So Lee, that's for people that come in person. I've heard there's a rumor that something's starting this week on Friday for those that are at home. Tell us about that.
That's really exciting, Corey. I can't tell you how excited I am to finally be bringing CR to people that can't get out to the building. It's going to be CR at home or CR virtual. And all you have to do in order to be a part of CR is send me an email asking for the Zoom link for CR, and you will be sent the Zoom link and invited. Each week, we send a new Zoom link, so you have to email me each week, but you will be invited to attend, and it will be an exciting time of seeing what goes on at CR and getting the benefits of it, even if you can't get to the building. And COVID's kept a lot of people away from the building.
Well, Lee, we have to actually start worship now. I just can't wait to see what God has for us today.
Good morning, Fusion Community Church. How's everyone doing at the 9:45 service this morning? All right, 8:30 was just as asleep as you are. It's okay. Let's stand and get the blood flowing. Let's worship together this morning.
We are children of your. Everybody. Good morning. Go ahead and have a seat. Thanks for coming out and worshiping with us. I hope you all found the worship guides as you walked in this morning.
Hey, good morning, Fusion at Home family. We are so glad that you're here with us today. I actually am online with one of our hosts and ministry leaders from Celebrate Recovery, Lee Pelletier. Hey, Lee, how you doing?
Hi, Corey. I'm doing great. How about you?
Great. So we're here with the Fusion family today, and we just wanted to share with them, I wanted them to be introduced to you because you're actually online with them today, interacting with them.
That's right. And I'm really glad to be there, and I hope they'll communicate on the chat as well as watching the service.
You know that I shared this last week, but there's actually an in-app messaging feature within our app that you'll be on as well. If you want to join Lee on that chat, even after the service, Lee probably can hang around a little bit and interact on that chat group on our app. As always, we always ask everybody, Lee, to check in online through the app. Let us know you're here. Share with us prayer requests. But at this point, we're actually going to go back into the worship center and continue our worship today. So we will see you online.
That'll be great, and I look forward to chatting with you.
But holy trust in Jesus' name.
Let's sing that again. My hope is built. When darkness seems
formally stand before the throne.
My heart.
never failed me yet.
Last few weeks we've been talking about an upside down kingdom, and I'm just going to kind of flip the script upside down with what we did in the first service. I'm going to invite you to have a seat for a second, and Ron's going to keep playing. The kids can go ahead and head to the back for Takuma Island, so you guys will have a great time there with Pastor Tim and Cindy and Mr. Barney, and we'll see you back here in a little bit. You know, in the content of that song, the content of Cornerstone, these two songs we've just sang, in fact, the first verse of Do It Again says, I've been walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. I think that is a sentiment that many of us would say applies into our own personal world in varying seasons, but definitely collectively. We've been circling these walls for a while, kind of praying, God, would they fall? And we're talking about this upside-down kingdom, this upside-down view on the world. That when we look through the lens of the cross and the empty tomb, our values change, our priorities change, that what we care about changes, what matters most to us changes. I want to share with you, I've got a pastor friend of mine that I've known for 5 or 6 years down in South Carolina at Eden Wesleyan Church. His name is Richard Hall. And I didn't know him prior to 5 or 6 years ago. He's about 20 years my senior, and he was going through some health assessments in his local church that's rural. And the team that was there had been here with us. They said, hey, you guys should get together. I think you have a lot to learn from each other. And so he came up, spent a weekend here with us at Fusion. And we just really connected with heartbeat and passion and calling. And so every time we've had to get together at various denominational events, we always find a corner to catch up. And of course, social media gives you that opportunity too to stay connected. About a month ago, his wife was hospitalized with COVID, and it's been a very difficult journey. And as I've been reading through, especially over the last couple of weeks, I've just been just wrecked for what they're going through, and yet at the same time inspired by the platform for ministry God is giving him in the midst of the valley. I mean, God hasn't failed him. God hasn't, he hasn't given up hope or faith. In fact, to a guy in a town where there's, you know, 1,000 or so that he's influencing through the local church in that community, now his posts are being shared by thousands, and thousands of more eyes are on them, and just seeing his faith lived out. I think you'll see what I mean. I just kind of want to read this before we pray as kind of an illustration of this kingdom life God calls us to, that even in the midst of the darkest days, there's still a blessing to be had. There's still the presence of God, that he doesn't fail us, that he walks through it with us. So this was about a month ago when he kind of first went just beyond his local church publicly onto social media with what was going on with his wife's health. He says, "I hesitate to share here. Social media is risky." Amen. "I've been sharing with my church family, but feel the need to share this with my friends. There's no need to respond to me. Just pray. My wife Sharon is in the hospital due to complications from COVID. She's been there since Sunday. Seems like every day we're getting a little weaker. Due to the protocols, I'm not allowed to visit, and that makes my assumptions worse. She's not on a ventilator, but we have moved to a rebreather mask. I received just a short text from her this morning that simply said, 'Please pray for me. I'm struggling to breathe. If the Lord brings her to mind, would you lift her up in prayer? I'm so thankful for the web of friends all over the country that I know love and care for Sharon and I. I deeply appreciate your prayers at this time.'" And I love this. He adds one more sentence. "I am so well aware that there are many others that are walking the same road that we're walking on. It's scary. I'm praying for you as well." He has an others-centered view. That's what the Holy Spirit does in us. Now, there was a lot more updates in the next 3 weeks. And without laboring you with all the details, there was a lot of monitoring. There was ups and downs for Sharon. He wasn't able to be there at the hospital with her. Many of you know what that's like. They put her on oxygen, then things got better. They took her off, and things got worse, and they intubated her. And then they ended up, she started to get better. They pulled her off, but then she started to fail again. So they put her back on and put her back into a, put her back under. And then there were 2 surgical procedures to deal with ways that the virus was attacking her organs and other complications. But I want to kind of catch up on this last week. I want you to hear the words of a kingdom of God mentality on the most difficult days in their lives. And this isn't something that happened weeks ago or years ago. This is happening right now. This was Valentine's Day last week. He just puts, "Please pray. Sharon's been placed on a ventilator and she's in rapid decline. We are frankly scared. They've lifted COVID protocol, so I'm heading to the hospital to visit with her, which is not a good thing, although she is still completely sedated. On Monday, Sharon's decline finally somewhat stabilized last night. She is on the ventilator and dialysis. She's had at least 4 units of blood, 2 units of platelets, and 2 units of something else." He put question marks. "Her blood pressure medicines are maxed out and the breathing machine was turned up during the night. The raw truth is that God and Sharon will decide where we go from here. We either start to get better or we just don't have anywhere left to go. Here's where it wrecks me. Many years ago, God called me to be a pastor," which we believe in the priesthood of all believers. We're all called to shepherd. We're all called to ministry. We're all called to that as followers of Christ. He says, "Many years ago, God called me to be a pastor in full-time ministry. Sharon's been a big part of that, as I have. He called us both. God's faithfulness has been and continues to be overwhelming. If God brings healing to Sharon's body, it will continue to be because of his faithfulness. If it's time for her to go home and celebrate with Jesus, then we will both fall into the arms of a faithful, loving Savior. One of us will be sustained through the pain and hurt, and the other will be welcomed home to the grandest of celebrations. My Savior has not and will not change. As a pastor, God has given me the gift of compassion and encouragement. It feels very strange to be on the receiving end of so much of that given from you. Because of that, I feel rude if I don't respond to every text or answer every call or post timely updates. I know how silly that is, and I also know you understand. So please understand if there's times that me and the kids just need to crawl under a rock for a bit to grieve. Understand it goes against my nature. I want to take care of you, not the other way around. I should be at the hospital later today when the doctors make their rounds, and so I hope to know more at that time. To all of you who are praying, to my church family who opened the church last night, the building, and so many came and prayed, thank you. To say we love and appreciate you is more than I can put into words." This was Thursday. The roller coaster ride continues. It's extremely difficult to share with you how sick Sharon really is. After a God-answering prayer kind of day yesterday, on Wednesday, we had some regression last night. She's struggling to breathe, is becoming very weak, as if she could have become any weaker. So the care team thinks the best chance she has for recovery is to reintubate her and put her back on the ventilator. This will give her the best option to rest and give her lungs some time to recover and the bleeding to continue to heal. We are still firmly hanging on to that thread of hope, and God is securely holding on to the other end. He's also firmly holding on to us. Thank you again for your prayer and support. Wish I had better news today, but God is still in control. And then this was on Friday. On my way into the hospital this morning, I was worshiping to one of my favorite songs entitled Graves into Gardens. Part of the lyrics go like this. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. Because the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. And then here's the chorus. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. He says, I can testify today that it's real. The presence of God to sustain you in the valley is real. I'm living it. Many of you are living it as well. If you don't know Jesus, I highly recommend him. When you go through the storm, you want a friend like him. Sharon's condition has remained the same overnight. Her breathing is still labored. She's still on the vent. Her care team described her condition as being steady. No real measurable improvement, no real measurable decline. Thank you for continuing to walk with our family during this crazy roller coaster ride called COVID. When you're holding on by a thread, remember, God made the thread, and he's holding the other end. I offer this as a word of encouragement in the midst of the valley. I don't know what your valley might be, what valley you've just come through, or maybe what valley lies ahead. But the presence of God, the power of God is real. It's tangible. And oftentimes, it's most identified, most experienced when things are the darkest. So let's pray and just bring the stuff of your life with you to place at the foot of the cross. Jesus, we give you glory and honor for the transformative work you do in us, for your presence, your promises, your power at work, and the change you cause in us when we walk with you. I thank you for, in the midst of the struggle, that Rich is using this as a platform for ministry in ways he couldn't have possibly imagined. As an inspiration and encouragement, as a word about what really matters in life, that this life is finite and temporary, but what matters most is eternity. And that's why the task of reaching people far from God is so near and dear to your heart, because you want to reconcile all your lost children. And you've called us as your body, your church, to tell that story, to live out the implications of the story of the good news, so that one more would come to faith in Jesus Christ at any cost. We lift up Rich and Sharon. We lift up her health. And even to allow her to stand in the gap for so many other families, even here in our own congregation. We thank you and praise you for the relief and the healing you've brought to many in our congregation, Lord, that have been right there as well. On oxygen, intubated, in the hospital for long periods of time. We're just so grateful for the relief that you've brought. But God, we echo the words of Rich, that whether each of us lives or dies to see tomorrow, you, Savior, are the same. Yesterday, today, and forever, you'll be there. Whether we see you face to face, we cross over into eternity, or whether we have to deal with the grief and the loss of people that matter the most to us, you'll be the same and you'll be faithful. So we bring you the valleys of life, God, the stuff that's burdening us, that we're struggling through. And we trust you with the outcome. God of the impossible, we trust you. Because nothing is better than you. No, there's nothing better than you. You're more than enough. And in the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. All God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, you know, 2 weeks ago, I shared with you a quote from a commentary by Michael Wilcock, just kind of elaborating on Luke chapter 6. And he says this, and I just want to start here, about this upside-down world, this upside-down view on life that Jesus not only models for us, but then he empowers us to live with his Holy Spirit. The whole reason for his rescue is not just for eternity, but for the here and now as well, that we can bring the life of heaven, the kingdom of heaven here to earth. So this is what he says. In the life of God's people will be seen, first of all, a remarkable reversal of values. The body of Christ, God's people, will prize what the world calls pitiable. That doesn't mean we seek it. I love his word choice here. Doesn't mean we seek what the world calls pitiable. It says we prize, we value the valleys of life because there's so much to be gained through them. And we know that the valleys in this life are short and temporary. We have eternity that's waiting. So we will prize what the world calls pitiable, and God's people will suspect what the world thinks is desirable. We will kind of look at the values of the world with speculation. He says, values which are taken for granted by other men and women are questioned by God's people. See, this reversal of values is what makes a Christian a Christian. It makes a believer, a follower of Jesus, a follower. It's experiencing the blessedness Jesus promises on the mountain peaks and in the valley. It's that our deep satisfaction doesn't come from our circumstances, but it comes from being connected and living life with our Savior. I want to run through a list of just reversals. Okay. Oh, we'll see if it sticks. So this reversal of values, I want to run through a list of things that Jesus teaches on, that he models in his life, but also things that the rest of what Paul writes and James writes, what they identify of this whole new lens of the world around. We'll go with green. Okay, so this is just a few things, not an exhaustive list, but just an introduction to the values of the kingdom of God. Jesus draws attention to how they differ from the values of this world. So, you know, last week we allotted an extra time of worship through song and receiving communion, and the emphasis that was shared by Corey and Gretchen and Tim was on this idea that worship can quickly become about us. Our songs, our styles, what we prefer, what gives us goosebumps, and we can put ourselves on center stage and make it all about the things we enjoy and what we like, and we can forget that worship is designed to help us return to build our lives on Jesus. That worship is all about what we're building our lives on as a foundation, and we'll either worship God and put Him first, or we'll worship something else. We've been designed as worshipers, and God wants to save us from building a foundation on something that can fall apart. In Matthew's gospel, we have a metaphor from Jesus Himself about this very thing. Listen to what He says in Matthew chapter 9. He says, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fail, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice, he says, not just about the content, it's about acting on it, putting it into practice. If you hear the words of mine and do not put them into practice, it's like a foolish man who builds his house on the sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the wind blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law. The question there is, well, what are we building our lives on? Are we building our lives on something that will last, which is Jesus and the Word of God and the Gospel? Are we building our lives? Are we emphasizing, valuing what the world values, something that's going to crumble and crash? In Luke 16, Jesus makes a huge statement that is not a politically correct statement in our world. In fact, right when he would have said this, he's basically saying that what society around you says is right and what God says is right is rarely ever on the same page. And when he says this, the crowd listening would have been, ooh, Jesus just went there. Like, these are fighting words. Here's what Jesus says. He says, what people value highly is detestable in God's sight. Now, he's not making an exclusive, you know, exhaustive statement about all of reality, but he's saying oftentimes what people in a broken, dark world value in their brokenness and darkness has nothing to do with what God wants. That's detestable in God's sight. He's saying that most of the time the conclusions that a lost, broken world comes to varies greatly from the conclusions that God declares is right, or what we highly value in our world, which puts us on center stage and gets us what we want, that glorifies ourselves. He says what God highly values is others, laying down your life for others. Jesus himself would do this. And in laying down our lives for others, we glorify our Savior. We glorify Jesus. Now, in this context, if you look in Luke chapter 16, he's identifying that it's normal for us to build our lives on financial wealth, financial foundation. That just makes sense. It just kind of fits with us intuitively. But Jesus is warning that so quickly that financial foundation can become an idol. And we cannot serve both God and money. We can only serve one master. Jesus has a lot to say about the dangers of the love of money, and he gives us a reversal of values to look at those resources and our lives as a bridge, that as we're blessed to get to be a blessing, whether it was 2,000 years ago or right now, everything he says has so much application into our lives. And in Matthew chapter 19, there's kind of He gives us this illustration or this metaphor. Jesus says, truly I tell you, it's hard for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished, and they asked, who then can be saved? What hope is there for anybody? Like, they understood how shocking of a statement this was, that 2,000 years ago, as well as today, so much focus and attention we put on the value of being financially comfortable in life. Now, just before this moment, in the same chapter, there's another topic that Jesus kind of turns upside down. It was common in that day and age, especially for men, that children were a nuisance. They would often slow you down. They would interfere with all that you had to get done. So there's this moment with the disciples where children come into the presence of Jesus, and they're kind of quick to say, no, he doesn't have time for you. He's too important. He's got too many things going on. He's got too much to accomplish. And what does Jesus do? He challenges them. He flips them upside down. He's like, whoa, 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 guys, let the little children come to me. And don't hinder them. Don't hold them back. For the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, belongs to such as these. And then he placed his hands on them and he blessed them and he went on from there. Now, I don't have time to get into all the context of all of these, but I just kind of want to run through some more of these values in the kingdom of God that are turned upside down when we look at the values of our culture. In Matthew chapter 5, just boom, 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 in the Beatitudes, we're given these countercultural ideas from Jesus. One of those, he basically says, you know, in secular culture says that you'll be happy when you go out and you get what you want and you earn it, because that's what makes life worthwhile. But Jesus says, blessed are you who hunger and thirst for righteousness, because you'll be truly satisfied. Like, you can go out and get everything you want in this world, and you still won't ever find satisfaction. You'll always want more. But when you hunger and thirst for righteousness, ultimately when you find Jesus, that he was righteous on your behalf, and then you choose to be obedient to him, you'll find satisfaction. He also says, you know, culture says you'll be happy when you get evil with that person who's wrong, when you get even with that person that has wronged you, for this is a mean world and they deserve what they get. But the Lord says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Turns it upside down. He also says, secular culture says you'll be happy and free. There's this ethic in society, especially today in our world. You'll be happy and free when we as society eliminate standards written in that Bible that's so outdated so you can live your truth. And Jesus says, no, blessed are you when you're persecuted because of righteousness, standing up for what the Word of God says. For yours is the kingdom of heaven. And he's saying that at a time in which people's lives are about to be taken from them by claiming Jesus is Savior. Like, he's saying this with a stark reality, as persecution is just a couple years away to those who are listening. Another thing, in Jesus' culture, women were seen as property. There's even a moment when two sisters, Mary and Martha, are in a house together. Jesus is there, and Martha is busy in the kitchen getting things ready to provide a meal. She's getting irritated and bitter and frustrated because her sister Mary is just hanging out in the living room, sitting at the feet of Jesus, listening and soaking up everything he's got, being in his presence. And so Martha comes in and kind of complains. And it would have been common in this culture for Jesus to correct Mary and send her into the other room to assist Martha. But Jesus flips it upside down. He says, Martha, no, 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 you're missing it. Mary's chosen the better thing. There's a time for serving. There's a time for preparation. But right now, the Son of the living God is in her living room, and she's soaking up my presence. She's listening to what I have to say about the truth of God and the truth of her life and her identity. And that's not going to be taken from her. That's incredibly valuable. But one of the subliminal things Jesus is doing in this moment is he is elevating women to the same place as men. He's saying every soul matters to God. Doesn't matter male, female, child. He's already affirmed the children. Now he's affirming Mary to be in the room with the men, to listen, to not miss this moment, to not be preoccupied with busy work, but the richness of the presence of God. He says, doesn't matter your creed, doesn't matter your color, doesn't mean it matter your language. Every person has value to Jesus. In Ephesians 6, the Apostle Paul would say, he would give us an idea of the real enemy, and he would turn it upside down. You know what? We battle not against flesh and blood. Even though at that time, as they were being persecuted, it was easy to look at the Jews or the Romans as their oppressors, as the enemy. And he says, no, we don't battle against flesh and blood. Even though in a polarized society, the enemy of God wants us to look at one another with aggression, God's word says, no, we don't battle against flesh and blood, but against spiritual forces opposed to God. We're called to be peacemakers. We're called to unify. We're called to love. Jesus would say in Matthew 23 that the greatest among us will not be leaders, it'll be those who serve. In Matthew 20, Jesus would give us this paradoxical idea. He said, the first will be last and the last will be first, which is hard to even wrap our minds around, but that's a kingdom value. In Romans chapter 12, God uses the Apostle Paul to just run through a list of things that flip upside down the script of what we think is normal in our sin-ridden world, in our sinful nature. He starts off Romans chapter 12. He says, don't conform to the pattern of this world. It's common to want to fit in. That's natural to your natural sin nature. You want to fit in. You want to get accepted. You want to get applause. You want to get approved. You want to get recognized. You want to find your value and your worth in society. He says, no, don't conform to that pattern of this world because it won't deliver on those promises. Be transformed by changing the way that you think upside down. Later on, he'd say, don't think of yourself as great, but with humility. He even says, I kind of paraphrased it this way. He says, you know, if you think about all the things you can't do very well, the sum of what you can't do that well, it's far more than what you can do well. Like, think about it. Everything you don't know and can't do far outweighs what you do know and can do. He's like, so the reality is you're not that great. So look at yourself with sober humility, recognizing that without God, you have little to offer. He even then says, you don't exist as a part of yourself. You're not amputated. You're a part of a greater whole. You're designed to be a part of the body of Christ. You might be a thumb. You might be a big toe. You might be a kneecap. You can't be any other part except the part God's wired you for. And you belong to one another, unified with one another. He says to honor each other more than you honor yourself. In Romans 12, he says, choose to be patient when you are experiencing affliction. Now think about it. This letter, the book of Ephesians chapter 6, would have been read in a church in the city of Ephesus. Probably someone in that gathering, as it was passed from house to house, this letter from Paul, this word is spoken, be patient in your affliction. Probably there was a wife who just saw her husband executed for his faith in Jesus somewhere in Ephesus because they were persecuted. And Paul's saying, be patient in affliction. And then we look at our afflictions and we're like, wow, why can't I be patient? I'm not facing that. He says in Romans 12, bless those who persecute you. That is not our natural inclination, right? We want to attack those who persecute us. Be eager to associate with people of low position. Lower position than you, whatever your position is, be eager to associate, to befriend, to get close to people of lower position than you. And then he also says, don't seek vengeance, but forgive and keep forgiving as God keeps forgiving you. In James chapter 1, James would write so much about what he learned from his half-brother Jesus. And he would say in the beginning of his what he was writing, and in chapter 1, verse 19, he says, be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. I think it's pretty easy for us to identify. This is not a value of the United States of America in 2021, is it? This is not a kingdom of this world value. There can be rhetoric saying it's important, but as Jesus said, if you don't put it into practice, you're building on sand that's going to crash. The church of Jesus is called to put it into practice. Quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. And then later on in the book of James, James says, one of the things I've learned is that the way of this world is condemnation. It's finger-pointing, blaming others. The kingdom of God reverses that value. It's confession of sin. Confess your sins one to another. You want to find healing? Healing isn't found by saying, you're wrong, and how dare you, and look what you did. Healing is found as you confess your sins one to another. You'll find healing. Admit where you haven't lived up to God's glorious standard. Then Jesus in Mark chapter 12, you know, there's a bunch of people that wanted to condemn. They wanted to point finger at the Romans as monsters. And they were looking at Jesus to justify them to not have to pay such a high tax rate any longer to the government. And Jesus flips the script. He makes a statement they were not wanting him to say. They were looking for justification to rebel or resist. And Jesus says, whose name, whose face is on the money? And they're like, crap, Caesar. He's like, then give to Caesar what's Caesar's. Give to God what is God's. Other places, Jesus would tell us what belongs to God. And he would model it for us as he would lay down his life for us. He would say, everything you have, even the breath in your lungs, belongs to your Creator. Everything. Bring everything to glorify the name of Jesus and the Father. And then Luke 17, Jesus gives us this idea. He says, if you want to gain your life, you'll lose it. And anyone trying to hold on to it will lose it. Another flipping the script. Now think about how fascinating this is. 2,000 years ago, Jesus taught these and so many other countercultural truths about who God is and what matters most to our Creator and how we can live free and whole. And even though 2,000 years has passed and society has evolved so much, and as human beings, we've grown and learned so much, every single one of these instructions are maybe more relevant now than they were 2,000 years ago. So the question then for us to sit in is, do you think you're more shaped by the culture around you, sharing the values of the broken world around you, celebrating what society celebrates, chasing what your coworkers chase, passionate about what other students at your school are passionate about, obsessed with satisfying the cravings of your flesh, driven by your own desires for comfort? Are you aligning your heart with the kingdom of this world? Or are you aligning your heart and values with the kingdom of God? Another way to ask this question is, what cultural values or passions in our world today might you be aligning yourself with, in agreement, maybe even emotionally supporting and hoping for, yet right now maybe the Holy Spirit's kind of whispering to your heart and challenging you, hey, son, daughter, re-examine where you sit in relationship to this, because you may not be in line with my heart and with my values. I mean, when Jesus came to earth, he set aside the power of God. He still had the power of God here on earth, but he accepted limitations to become human. He had to sleep. He had to eat. He had to go to the bathroom. We even know Jesus was big on napping. Like, that's something we often forget. If you like napping, just say, hey, Jesus napped, I can nap, right? He liked napping. There's a lot of times where he's taking a nap. He left behind the power and the autonomy of God to come in human form as a servant. He left the comfort of heaven. He left the success in his position of Son of God to become lowly and to become poor. He left the full recognition by the angels as the Son of God and was called a heretic. Was called a false king. His life was given for us. He chooses to lay aside all those benefits of his position as Son of God so that he could present to us what an upside-down reality looks like to live in this world and to give us the power to live it. I mean, he was the one that would come and touch the lepers that nobody else would touch. He was the one that would give himself to the poor. He would be poor himself, right? He rides into Jerusalem on a borrowed donkey. He has his last meal in a borrowed room. His body is buried in a borrowed tomb. He didn't have the resources for any of those things. And he gives his life up on the cross. Everything. He models that the kingdom of God, and he models the values of the kingdom of God in a way we can understand and we can begin to follow him in. But more than just try to follow his example, he gives us so much more than a model. He establishes the power, the property, the pattern, and the product of an upside-down life, an upside-down worldview. You could say, as I've titled the message today, the fruits of an upside-down life. What are the power, property, pattern, and product of an upside-down life? And get this from that quote early on. This is not living life as a victim. This isn't a life seeking suffering, not seeking weakness, but understanding that in the most joyous moments of life and in the most heartbreaking, God is with us there, and he has something for us to gain. And perhaps in the midst of our deepest struggles and our most heartbreaking experiences, the platform for ministry might be the greatest. As people lean in to listen and watch, if our faith is real and if we're living that upside down life that God can use. So what's the power? The power to live out this new life. The power to live it out is the power that gives us life in the first place. It's God's Spirit. Jesus gave us a model to live by, but then he gives us the power of his Spirit, the same power that raised him from the dead. Because we can't live this life upside down on our own power. We can't even fake it for a little bit. We need the power of God's Holy Spirit. We get to be the temple of God. The second thing is the property. You are the property of the kingdom of God. It's you. It's not land that's gained through conquest. It's not like the Old Testament, this idea of Israel and the promised land. It's about souls that are rescued when they choose to respond to the gift of the blood of Jesus that washes away our sin. We are purchased at the highest price, the blood of the Lamb. We are redeemed souls, lost children, are the property of the kingdom of God. There's a pattern to this upside down kingdom of God, and that is to say yes to Jesus in ever increasing ways, more than we say yes to ourselves, yes to our culture, yes to our flesh, yes to our spouse. We say yes to Jesus more than we say yes to any other master in our life. We can't serve two masters. We can only have one. This is why the journey of discipleship is so necessary. It's why for over a year now we've been doing these discipleship rallies trying to emphasize the beauty of obedience and moving from rows into circles to foster relationships, because God designed community to be the catalyst of growth for us. Really, the key word here is control. A Jesus follower is not controlled by the same things. Someone a part of the kingdom of God is not controlled by the same things as someone is a part of the kingdom of this world. Not controlled by power, not controlled by success, not controlled by recognition, not controlled by comfort, not controlled by money. And if those things or the desire for those things control us, what does that mean? They're our master and we will serve them. We will do anything we can to get them and to hold them and to keep them. The pattern of the kingdom of God is, I'm going to say yes to Jesus. I'm going to say yes in obedience to him. I'm going to say yes to believe and trust his word and not to buy the lies presented in a broken world. Because the things of this world, as we walk it out, as we walk out our faith relationship with Jesus, the things of this world matter less and less and less and less. That's the pattern, an ever-increasing yes to Jesus. And then the product. The product of the kingdom of God is that Jesus puts us where he alone deserves to be, in relationship with a holy God. He puts us at the throne of God where we can stand in the righteousness of Christ. And Jesus can call us to reverse our values because he's reversed our value. He's given us access to our dad. You and I deserve to be rejected by a holy God, but Jesus himself accepted rejection on our behalf. He was rejected and despised in our place. So now what's the calling for us as followers of God? We're called to do that for others, to lay out our lives for them so they can be accepted and affirmed, to be willing to accept rejection. We follow Jesus' demonstration of rational generosity because we recognize the resources we have at our disposal are to be a bridge of blessing to others for the sake of rescuing them. The product of the kingdom of God is Jesus living his life through us, his peace, his joy, his kindness, his goodness, his gentleness, his generosity, the power of his spirit. Now, I want to end with just giving you a quick illustration, and I hope this kind of paints a picture for you of something you can identify with. Probably a situation we've all been in at some point or another. Probably a situation where we've given in. Other times where we've stood firm. I want to give you kind of one kind of big picture illustration. And you could kind of think about the Holy Spirit can help you process what this means in your context. But let's say at work, you're in a moment. You're in a situation where you can choose to lie and you know you'll keep your job. Or you could choose to tell the truth and it might cost you your job. And maybe even something little. It's not even a big deal from the world's standards, but for you, you're wrestling with conviction over that. I want to illustrate you the process of thinking that goes through our heads, and we don't sit down and we write this out. This is just kind of what happens naturally. This is what happens from the kingdom of this world's perspective and that lens, and then there's another way in which, if we're a part of the kingdom of God and what God is doing to renew our minds and transform our thinking, how it looks differently. But so much of our day-to-day life has to do with how we reflect on and preach the gospel truth to ourselves over and over and over again. So let me illustrate the rule of the kingdom of this world. If there's a threat on your job and you have to do something that would maybe compromise your values to keep it, there's a temptation that says, well, I need this job. There might even be a temptation beyond that says, well, I need this job, but I also want this job. I want the income. I don't want to live without the income that I have. And that income can become an idol. That's where wealth, you can build on the sand. You might start to think, well, I can't live without the car, and what are we going to do? I can't live without the house. I want the comfort, I want the position, the recognition, the title. You don't know that there's a guarantee you can get another job with the same benefits package. And by the way, everybody else does it too. You start to justify, well, it's just a little lie, and this is just kind of a part of the industry. It's a part of the market. And yet, if you participate, if you give a little bit, and you compromise, you're going to feel that stress and that tension. And there's going to be an anger because you had to do that in order to keep your job. The problem is one little lie that becomes hundreds of little lies, all of a sudden there's not conviction anymore. This is just what you do because you're so separated yourself from those values in the kingdom of God. So the power in the kingdom of the world is held by the boss. They have the ultimate power, he or she. Ultimate power, you're at their mercy. You have to do whatever they want you to do, even if you compromise your values in order to keep the position. The property is you. It's the same as the kingdom of God, but this time you're enslaved to your desires. You're enslaved to your wants. You're enslaved to what you think you need, and you think you're the one that provides it for yourself, which is not biblically accurate. We'll get into that in a minute. Even though deep down you know it'll never make you satisfied, all those things you're chasing. The pattern is not I say yes to Jesus. It's I say yes to whatever I have to do to keep what I have. Or to get more. I have to fight to get what I want. And then the problem of the kingdom of this world is just guilt and shame and misery and disappointment and compromise. and convictions become a distant memory. Now, let me contrast that with what it looks like to be a part of the upside-down kingdom of God. When you're presented with that moment, you immediately realize, well, I didn't get this job. God gave me this job. I didn't give myself this income. God has blessed me with this. All these things are a gift from God, even the breath in my lungs, and the abilities I have are given to me by God, because what I can't do and what I don't know far outweighs what I can do and what I do know. I understand who I am. I understand what I have to offer, and God has opened a door in my life for this season to provide for me, because I don't provide for myself. He provides for me. He's opened a door to provide for me. It's something that I'm good at, and I get satisfaction from getting to accomplish it, as God intends for work to be something we gain satisfaction from. But when presented with a circumstance where you feel you have to lie to keep what he's blessed you with, you won't compromise because you believe God is your provider and he can provide another open door. It's not the business, not the boss, not the market, not the economy, but God controls and provides for you what you need. So you will seek his kingdom first and foremost, and you know all these other things will be provided to you that you need by him. And you trust him more than you trust a boss, more than you trust a business, more than you trust yourself, your own education, more than you trust a bank account. You even trust him enough that if your standard of living was to go down, you know that at least you'll still be at peace because you said yes to him and his values, and you rejected compromise. In the Beatitudes we read earlier, there's this idea that blessed are those who weep, for they will be comforted. Blessed are you when you're persecuted for doing what's right, because as a son or daughter of the king, you're inheriting the whole kingdom. In eternity, you know the whole kingdom. You're an heir of the kingdom of God. This means that when you get bad news, when you experience hardship, even over and over again in life, in that moment, there's weeping. There's sadness when we go through hard things. Even over and over again, when we suffer, in those moments, we weep. We don't have to dismiss the pain. Nowhere in Scripture does it say, just forget about the pain, just push it aside, it doesn't exist. No, it exists. We're taught to grieve. Jesus himself grieved. But even those seasons of grieving, there's something that's offered to us that God wants to use as he shapes us. As a part of the kingdom of God, when presented with that circumstance, you begin to understand that the job, the work, the title, the income, the recognition, none of it defines you. It doesn't calculate your worth. Because what measures your worth greater than anything else is the gift of the Son of God on the cross and his life taken, buried in the tomb, and resurrected on the third day. The job is just a job. The opportunities come and they go. You can take them or leave them. You're not afraid of power. You're not afraid of success. You're not afraid of money or wealth. But you're also not afraid of suffering or weeping, because God is the same in all those circumstances. And if those things are gone, if they're taken, you don't have to throw your hands up and say, my life as I know it is over. No, if you lose them, you're set free from bitterness, because what happens here in this world is temporary anyway. It doesn't last. Now, I know these are easy things to say, easy things to process in our mind. They're completely different when emotions are involved. And even maybe somebody here today, somebody watching online, you're going through a deep valley in your life. It's like, man, this sounds good, but there is freedom. I promise you. I go back to the words I started with, Pastor Rich. The presence of God is real. It's tangible in the deepest valley. Don't lose hold of the thread that God is holding onto you with. He will never fail. We just sang that. You've never failed. You're not going to start now. Lord, do it again. Move the mountains. Even just move the mountains of distraction so I can see you clearly in the midst of the struggle. He's given you the power. You are the property. He will author the pattern as you say yes to him, and he will bring forth the fruit, the product that he wants to bring about in the redemptive work in your life. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the good news. It's always good because it reminds us of where we truly stand in relationship to you, and the significance of the cross and the tomb, the significance of your plan from the foundation of the world to rescue us and redeem us. I know, Lord, we've covered a lot of content today, probably too much. Lord, would your Holy Spirit just write upon our hearts what it is we need to carry out of this place and apply it into our lives so, as Jesus says, we can put it into practice. Not just leave with more content, but to put it into practice and to keep putting it into practice. I pray over the next 2 days as we'll gather in this room and online, for those of us that are hungry about growing in our faith and welcoming the conversation around these great truths about God, Lord, would you just fill that conversation with your Spirit, and would you nurture us as we seek you? In your awesome and holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, hey, today, if you want to join us in person tomorrow, the cutoff is 4 p.m. today, so you just need to get registered then so we have food and childcare provided. You can, if you miss that deadline, you can always register for the online one, which will just be from a screen, and we'll put you into rooms for conversation. Hey, next week, we're going to kick off a new series, and it's kind of a next step from this series. How many people have ever made, I'm talking about old cassette tapes, a mixtape? You ever made a mixtape, right? Boyfriend or girlfriend in high school, you spent hours laboring over just the right songs in the right combination so that you could write your love to that other person. So next week, we're going to start a series called Mixtape Parables, and we're just going to look at parables of Jesus and how he's communicating his love for us, but also he's showing us how to live this upside-down life. He's giving us principles and values that change the way we live life in the same world everybody else does, but it sets us free in so many amazing ways. We'll say goodbye to everybody. Join us online. Thanks for worshiping with us and leaning in for the conversation. Would you just stand with me? I'm just going to pray with you.
Well, I hope that message challenged you and encouraged you, maybe even gave you something new to think about this upside down kingdom, that each of us, after we've said yes in faith to Jesus, we are a part of the property of the kingdom of God, this upside down kingdom. And that's kind of a cool way to think, that's what God values more than anything else in all creation. That's what he's reclaimed and reconciled to himself. As you're a part of Fusion Community Church from a distance, whether that be right here in Schoharie County and at home, whether that be somewhere else, I just want to share with you that you can help support what happens here in ministry at Fusion. And you can do that through the app. It's not the easiest way. You can also click the online giving option on our website, and you can just say, hey, you know what, this is my home church, I'm tithing here. Or if you want to say, hey, you know what, this is a ministry that's supplemental to my spiritual life, and you want to give generously an offering or something to be a blessing and to continue to further the reach of Fusion Community Church, we just want to say thank you for that, and we want to make sure that those links are available to you, and you can find those very easily on the app and the website. Hey, I want to pray for you, because you are still in the process, the pattern of the kingdom of God, and I want to lift you up this week in anticipation of whatever you might face that you don't know is coming, or whatever doors God might be opening to show the power of God at work within you, so he can bring about the product of what he wants to do to bring you to completion. His promises are a guarantee, and he's going to continue to do that sanctifying work in us. So I just want to pray with you before we go. Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for today and the opportunity to worship together with those who are joining us right now. I pray over them where they are right now, at home. I pray over marriages. I pray over families. I pray over those who might be single. Lord, I pray over their work. I lift up the challenges they may be facing in their careers or in their home or in their school. Lord, I pray over the battle that is waging in this time in our lives through COVID and so many things that we feel have been taken from us. Lord, may you help us to change the way we think, turn us upside down, and recognize that those things that maybe have been taken from us, they're opportunities to look at this world in a new way and to find ourselves with hearts that are grateful for what we have been blessed with. Lord, I pray for blessings over each person that's watching this, and I pray that they have a sense this week that you are with them, that you are their advocate, that you are also their provider. They don't provide for themselves, but you provide. And Lord, that you're going to open doors where you want to open doors. Would you give them the courage and the faith and the sensitivity to hear your voice speak and to help them walk through the doors that you open, knowing that they don't have to own the results. They don't have to own the product, God. You're the one that delivers the product. We just have to be committed to the process, to the journey, and saying yes to you in faith. We ask all these things in your awesome and mighty name. Well, thanks so much for joining us, everybody. Thank you.